Hello, Phyllis Moore here, Philosophically Speaking, and I hope that so far your day is going well. I invite you, if you have not already, to click like, share, subscribe, be part of this conversation and journey that we call life. I do hope that as your day is going on today, it is in a good category for you, because there's all kinds of potential every day when we get up. Things kind of change quickly and sometimes on a dime. And if you can keep an even keel, that's great, but it's not always possible to do that. I know things can run the gamut from good, great, happy, right on down the spectrum to devastating or disappointing. And I hate that word, and I'll tell you why. Because for me, there was a point in time when I was married to someone else, and it reached a crescendo of, well, there was abuse, but it wasn't physical abuse. I've never had that experience where I've had someone be violent or hit me or be having that kind of scenario. But I have been involved in situations where there was emotional, psychological, or verbal abuse. And I'm not going to debate what's worse. They're all bad. They are all bad if people mistreat us. But I cannot attest to, you know, someone that had hit me or been violent toward me in that way. So when people say, oh, I would never let someone hit me, I would not put up with that, I would not stay, that's easy to say, but we are not walking in someone else's shoes. We don't know what would happen when these things occur. You know, police will tell you that the worst or one of the worst things you can get involved in is in the middle of a domestic dispute, because while someone may call for help when you get there, they will just as quickly say, oh, no, don't take him away, I love him, and, you know, whatever. Then they gang up on the police officer. But that's another whole issue. I will say that I believe, and I am living proof of this, and my children as well, that we, you know, you do suffer long-lasting effects from verbal or emotional or psychological abuse. We don't even know. It's a very intangible thing. So everybody deals with it differently. I am not going to judge. I will just say that it was very difficult. And at one point, I went to an agency that handled domestic violence cases. And the woman, I'll give you two nuggets, because I think this is important, especially if you or someone that you know is going through any kind of situation, whether you want to call it abusive or not. Sometimes it's very unclear. You know, we don't pick up on it. It's not like someone slaps you in the face. It might be something that's said. It might be a tone. It might be a knee-jerk reaction, whatever. It's very fluid. And it can have damaging effects, far-reaching effects, and sometimes we don't even pinpoint. And that happened for me. I didn't have a term for it. But in this case, when I did go seek help, counseling, whatever, the woman asked me, why do you stay? And I don't know that I had a real clear-cut answer. Part of it was because I was a stay-at-home mom, and I wanted to continue in that role. I wanted to be there for my children. I wanted to protect them. But I also didn't feel like I had sufficient funds or money to take care of my children. Where was I going to go? I was 800 miles away from my family. And I kept a suitcase packed and in the trunk of my car in case I had to leave in the middle of the night, just because it kind of made me feel better to have that, even though, you know, it wasn't, like I say, it wasn't physical violence. But sometimes you just feel very helpless and you feel like you don't have a recourse or a voice. The other question that I was asked was, what message are you sending your children by staying? And that was another hit you between the eyes kind of thing, because I realized in that moment there were two ways I could answer that. One, by staying in a situation that's not healthy, not functional, and not, you know, good for any of us, then, you know, they're either my children, daughters were either going to learn that this is how you deserve to be treated, or this is how what treatment you accept, or this is, you know, just the way it is, and you have no control and no recourse and no rights. Or they would grow up thinking, I'm not putting up with that. I will not do that. And, you know, so neither of those were great answers, right? But in any event, I ended up getting a order of protection. I went to, before, I didn't go before the judge. I wrote down some of the things that had happened. I didn't even have to see the judge. He read some of this and granted an order of protection. And it was one of the hardest things because we're still living in the same house. We are all still living in the same house. And I remember that afternoon, the police came to my door to deliver this order of protection. Can you imagine that? I am in the house. He is upstairs sleeping. The last thing I wanted was, let me go wake him up and have you serve him this while I'm still living there. I lied. Sorry, I lied. Statute of limitations, it's been, you know, 20 years ago now, but I lied and said, oh, he's not here. And Monday, this was a Friday, Monday, when I went to pick up the kids from school, I just stayed away. I thought on the off chance that police officer comes back, I do not want to be at home. Well, what was interesting was nothing happened. Nothing happened for several days. I mean, and I'm talking, I knew it had been given to him, but he just didn't talk to me, didn't say a word. And for days, every time I'd be home and he'd be there, I'd get the meal on the table and he would come in and eat with us. And I thought, this is the most bizarre thing, but probably no more bizarre than the whole scenario had been for a number of years. Probably about the third or fourth day, kids were out of the house. Something was brought up and he said something about, you know, I got served with this paper. And he was insulted, not, and angry, not, oh my gosh, I've been chastised, I've been caught, I am guilty of anything. No, he was very angry with me because how embarrassing that was that this police officer came and he, you know, do you know who I am? I mean, you know, he was visible and people knew him. And he was like, you know, this is a slam on my reputation. Yeah, because it's all about you, buddy. But he said to me in that moment, he said, for the past few years, I have been so disappointed in you. And I just didn't realize it at the time, but I internalized that. I internalized that I am a disappointment. I see that differently now, but I carried that for a long, long time. Just like I did this message when I was probably 7, 8 years old, and I've got a picture of me in fourth grade with this weird hairstyle that it was like probably about this short, and I didn't have bangs. My mom would pull this one piece of hair and she'd put a little pin curl there. So she'd kind of use a hairpin and keep it out of my face, whatever. And only because this particular picture that I'm remembering, I think I just had this, I don't know what they say, an RBF, you know, resting B face, you know, where you're like, you know, it's not the most flattering. And this picture was probably like a reject from your driver's license photo that would be like, oh gosh, I don't use that one. Or the countless selfies that you take and do not post on social media. But in this particular case, I just had this sad look on my face, like, you know, didn't like the hairstyle, didn't like the face. I don't know. It probably was an outtake at best. But when I see that little girl, I always think of the boy that was on the bus every day that sat behind me, and he would say, tell me, you're ugly. You're ugly. You're ugly. And he said it like every day, to the point where you finally feel like, okay, buddy, got it. I'm ugly. Okay, I got your message. Thank you. Let's move on. But my point is that we hear things that people say to us, whether they say them quietly or in front of everyone else, or they laugh at us or whatever. So from someone telling me at 8 years old that I was ugly to being married to someone who you would think would value you enough to say, you know, you're wonderful and all this other, to say you've been a disappointment to me. We internalize those and they hurt. Words hurt. I know that people will say, sticks and stones will break my bones, but words will never hurt me. They do hurt us. They do hurt us. So when you put your words together, put them together in a really good way. You know, make sure your words are sweet and soft because you may have to eat them one day. And whatever people have told you, whatever disappointing, hurtful, internalized things that we hold as if they're true, and we give power to people. We give power and authority to people who have no business having that authority because they will abuse that authority. You know, rise above that. I know it's hard to do. I'm not saying that I'm good at it. I'm just saying that over time, I have come to see that this one little boy may have told me I'm ugly, but God does not think I'm ugly, because God does not create junk. He does not have a do-over and say, oh, I really messed up on this one. No, the Bible says we were all created in God's image, and He loves us all. And He doesn't love us conditionally. He doesn't sit there and say, well, you know, whatever. And I'm sure we're a disappointment to God because we're not perfect. But He loves us in spite of that. He loves us because He created us as special children of His. And that, to me, I'm so glad that I have that image. I'm so glad that I have that example. And I am so glad that we get a do-over and a second chance and a third and a fourth. And I, for one, hope that you will know that you are valuable and you are special and you are a treasure. And do not give people power and authority and the right to define you and say who you are. Remember whose we are. So one day I'll share, I kind of shared more of that kind of thought in my testimony, but it was very long when I spoke to a woman's group. One day maybe I'll share that message. But for today, I just want you to know that you are valued and you are special because, hey, you cannot have any more authority higher than God. And if He says we're good, we are good. So please enjoy your day. I encourage you to keep coming back, and we will try to navigate this path and know that you are not alone. We are in this together. Click like, share, subscribe, keep up. I want us to keep going on this journey together because we can do it. We don't have to be by ourselves. Take care.